Hello students, as you know, in our previous session we have started revising the chapter number 5, that is separation of substances. So what were the different topics that we have revised in our previous session? In our previous session we have studied the different methods for the separation of substances. The different methods that we studied are hand picking method, threshing, winnowing, sieving, sedimentation, decantation and filtration. So I hope all these topics are clear to you. So in today's session we will revise the remaining chapter. Today let's study another method for the separation of substances, that is evaporation method. How? By using the evaporation method we can separate the substances from the mixture. How is it possible? What do you mean by evaporation? Evaporation is the process of conversion of water into its vapor. When the water is converted into its vapor form, this process is known as evaporation process. For example, if we are having the salt and water solution and we keep this solution to heat on a flame, and after some time what we will observe that in the vessel the salt residues are present. As all the water gets evaporated, what will be left behind? The salt is left behind. In the similar manner we get the salt from the sea water by the evaporation process. So we have studied how the evaporation method is useful in separating the substances from the mixture. We have studied the different methods that are used for the separation of substances. How? By using the different methods we can separate the substances from the mixture. Now we will study how by using more than one method we can separate the mixture. So in which case we can use more than one method for the separation of substances? So let's see how to separate a mixture of sand and salt. So if you are given a mixture of sand and salt, how you will separate that mixture? Will it be possible for you to separate the sand and salt mixture by the hand picking method? No, it won't be possible. Or by the sieving method, can we separate the salt and sand mixture? No. As both are the fine particles, we can't separate them through the sieving method. So how is it possible to separate the sand and salt mixture? Now, keep the mixture in a beaker and add some water to it. What we have to do? We have to take the sand and the salt mixture in a beaker and add some water to it. Leave the beaker aside for some time. Why we have added water? What the water will do? We know that sand is insoluble in water and salt is soluble in water. So by adding water, salt dissolves in the water, while the sand will not dissolve in the water. Sand will settle down at the beaker, as it is insoluble. So we can separate the sand and salt and water mixture by the decantation or by the filtration method, isn't it? We can either decant that the salt and the water liquid from the sand, or we can filter that mixture. What will happen by the filtration? As we filter, we can get the sand particles on the filter paper. And we can collect the salt and water mixture in a beaker, isn't it? Now, what does the decanted liquid contain? It will contain both salt and water mixture. Now, we need to separate the salt and water from the decanted liquid. Now, we have to separate the salt from the water. Just now, we have studied we can separate the salt and water through the evaporation process, isn't it? Now what we will do, we will transfer the salt and the water mixture into a kettle and close its lid. We have to transfer the liquid into a kettle and close its lid. Now heat the kettle for some time. What will happen if you will heat the kettle? The steam will come out from the spout of the kettle. As we heat, the steam will come out from the spout of the kettle. Now take a metal plate with some ice on it. Hold the plate just above the spout of the kettle. Now what you have to do, you have to take a metal plate with some ice and hold that plate in front of the spout of the kettle. When the steam comes in the contact with the metal plate cooled with ice, it condenses and forms the liquid vapor. As we heat the liquid, what will happen? The steam will come out. Steam being hot, as it will come in the contact with the cooled metal plate, it condenses. That is, the steam particles, that the water vapor, will get converted into the liquid water. The steam will convert into liquid when it will come in contact with the cool metal plate. The process of conversion of water vapor into its liquid form is called as a condensation. So, the process in which water vapor gets converted into the liquid form, it is known as the condensation process. What we have studied in the evaporation process? In the evaporation, we have studied that the liquid form gets converted into the water vapor. So, condensation and evaporation both are the opposite process. In condensation, water vapor gets converted into liquid form. Now, after all the water has evaporated from the kettle, what will be left behind? What you will observe in the kettle? You will observe that the salt residue will be present in the kettle. As all the water gets evaporated, the salt is left behind. Thus, we can separate sand, salt and the water using the decantation or the filtration process. We have separated sand from the liquid through decantation and the filtration process. Then we have used evaporation and the condensation process to separate the water from the salt. So the different processes are used to separate the sand and salt mixture. Now we will study, can water dissolve any amount of substance in it? We know that water is a universal solvent. Why water is a universal solvent? As large amount of substances are soluble in water, water is said to be a universal solvent. But if we add any amount of substance to the given amount of the water, will that substance will dissolve in the water? We know that some substances dissolve in water and forms a solution. If we dissolve some substances in the water, it will form a solution. For example, if we dissolve a sugar in water, it will form a sugar and water solution. These substances are soluble in water. Now, what happens if you go on adding more and more of these substances to the fixed quantity of the water? Now, to study how much amount of the substance or a solute a water can hold, we will perform an activity. To perform this activity, we will require beaker, spoon, salt and water. What we will do now, pour half of water in a beaker, add 1 teaspoon of salt and stir well until salt dissolves completely. What you have to do, you have to fill the beaker half with the water. To this, you have to add 1 teaspoon of a salt and stir it well. What you will find that the salt will completely dissolve in water. Again, add a teaspoon of a salt and stir well. This time also, if you will add a salt, it will dissolve in water. Now, go on adding salt 1 teaspoon at a time and stir. So, after adding a few spoons of a salt, what you will find? That this salt will not dissolve. It remains undissolved and settle at the bottom of the beaker. Isn't it? Why this happens? This means that no more salt can be dissolved in the given amount of the water. The solution is now said to be saturated. So, as the solution is saturated, it can't hold any amount of salt in it. Now, heat the saturated solution, the salt will dissolve in water. Now, if you will heat that saturated solution, you will find that the salt will dissolve in the water. What does this mean? That if we increase the temperature, the saturation of the solution also increases. So here we completed the revision of this chapter. Now, some assignment questions are given to you. You can write the answers for this in your notebook. Let's see the first question. To use a sieve to separate the sand and rice seeds, what should be the size of the holes of the sieve in comparison to the size of the sand particles and the rice seeds? So, what could be the answer? We have to separate the sand and the rice seeds. So, we have to choose the sieve. What should be the size of the holes of the sieve so that we are able to separate the sand and the rice seeds? The size of the sieve should be larger than the sand particles and smaller than the rice seeds. Why? As the sand can easily pass through the holes while the rice seeds can be retained on the sieve. By this way, we can separate the sand and rice. Now let's have a look on the second question. A bottle contains either salt or a chalk. How will you find out what it has without tasting it? So, there is a bottle which contains either salt or a chalk. So, you have to determine that what does the bottle contain without tasting it. How is it possible? What we will do? We will fill a glass with the water and mix that content of the bottle in that glass. If the salt is present, it will dissolve in the water. And if the chalk is present, it will be insoluble in water. By this way, we can confirm that what is present in the water, that is either salt or the chalk. Now, the third question. Mention the methods that can be used for the separation of the following mixtures. So, the two sets are given. You have to mention the methods how you can separate the mixture. First is wheat, sugar and husk. How wheat, sugar and husk can be separated from each other? Husk can be separated from wheat and sugar by winnowing method. As it is lighter compared to wheat and sugar, so it can be separated from winnowing method. After winnowing wheat, the husk particles will be removed. Then only wheat and sugar will be left. Now how we will separate the wheat and sugar? By sieving. As the wheat and sugar differ in the size, we can use the sieve to separate them. Second is sand, black gram and husk. So how this can be separated? The sand can be separated from the black gram and the husk by sieving method. We will sieve them. After that, black gram and the husk will remain. Husk lighter than the black gram can be separated by the winnowing method. By this way, we can separate those mixtures. Now fourth, the image given below represents which process? So, in the image, which process can you see? It is a condensation process. Fifth question is, the mixture of chalk and water are separated by the following process. Identify the process and label the diagram. So, which process it is? It is the filtration process. You can draw the diagram in your book and label the different parts of the filtration assembly, like funnel, stand, beaker, filter paper, etc. So, we will end our session here.